John, are we on?
We are.
Okay, I'd like to welcome everyone to the August 17, 2011 Town Council Workshop. Let's set off with the Pledge of Allegiance first.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, one housekeeping, well, actually two items to mention. Councilor Levy is excused this evening. He's out of town. And agenda item number two is not going to be discussed this evening. So we will start off with we've got approval of minutes for the August 3rd, 2011 business meeting. Is there a motion?
Make a motion to approve the minutes of the August 3rd meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? Councilor Bentley, were you on for the motion?
No, that was the motion.
Seeing no discussion, Mr. Winowski, will you call the vote, please?
Councilor Bentley?
Aye.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor Zink?
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro?
Abstain.
Councilor Bodiman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 5-0, one abstention. Councilor, can you just state while you're abstaining?
Yeah, I was not present.
Just for the record. Thank you. Okay. First agenda item is Carl DeLeo, I believe it is. DeLoy, I'm sorry. He's from EPA, and we've asked him here this evening, so perhaps we can have an open dialogue on the discussion that we had at the last council meeting in reference to the memorandum of understanding on the nitrogen level and the testing and everything else. So we've asked him to come this evening to basically give us, we can ask him some questions, he can ask us anything he so pleases, but primarily it's to get a feel for what EPA thinks of this whole process. I think that would be the best way to put it. Could you step up, please? And that way there, if any councilors would like to start, or do you have anything you'd like to start off with?
Well, I'd just like to say thanks for inviting me up. I live down in Plastow, just outside of this watershed, so this is fairly familiar country to me. And if I understand it, you all are trying to decide whether to spend a significant amount of money on some studies outside of the work that the state has done already. And I didn't know if you wanted to ask specific questions of me, but I guess what I would say is we haven't selected a final permit number for Exeter, which is the only permit we've proposed. And as you know, we haven't proposed a permit limit for Newmarket yet. So the question of what the final limit will be is still open. The comment period is closed, but that does not mean we wouldn't look at additional scientific information that might be generated by whomever it's generated. It would have to be quality data, obviously, and we have ways of determining that. And certainly this work that's been proposed, which quite honestly I'm not familiar with in a detailed sense. The scope of work has not been given to us, so we don't know exactly what it is, but have a rough idea. But that is not the last of the work to be done by any means. EPA and the state and others, UNH, will continue to monitor the estuary and try to characterize it more fully. It is a complex system. There is uncertainty involved, and there always will be. There is no model, there's no investigation that is going to completely reveal all the secrets of the estuary. So that's something that you should be aware of. And some people have dedicated their lives to studying just a portion of the estuary, and still there's work to be done. In terms of the permit writing itself, New Hampshire is one of just four states in the country that do not write permits. So almost anywhere else in the country, the state of New Hampshire would be writing this discharge permit, and you would be talking to Ted Deers or somebody from the state. In New Hampshire, and coincidentally in Massachusetts, the EPA writes the discharge permits. The state has not requested, and we have not delegated authority to them. So that's how it turns out. You're dealing directly with the federal government. So every permit that's ever been written in this watershed and in the state of New Hampshire has been written in our shop. And we think we know what we're doing. We've never lost on appeal in terms of a permit limit being too stringent. We've only lost on appeal once. And in that case, the Environmental Appeals Board said, EPA, you weren't stringent enough in this permit. And it was remanded to us to go back and take another look at it. So that's a little bit of the background. Obviously, you all have to decide whether you want to spend these monies, and I understand it's a significant amount of money. Rest assured, we will look at the data. However, I think it's fair to say that there's many years of data that have been accumulated. The Lamprey River watershed has been studied extensively. So there's a lot to look at, and we have looked at it, and we're pretty sure that we understand what needs to be done. And by that I mean we understand the permit that we have to write in order to be able to legally defend it, which is the standard. So we can't write a permit that we feel like writing. We can't write a permit that takes into consideration a lot of extraneous stuff. We just have to write a permit that can be defended legally. That's the standard. Now, what I would say is, and we've had some discussions with Exeter recently, maybe we should be having some discussions along the lines of, and this would have to be after Newmarket, to be meaningful, after Newmarket has a draft permit proposed, perhaps we could sit down and see if there is an alternative approach to getting to that final limit. And so what does that mean? That means it's possible that we could look at two steps to getting to the final limit. And in return for doing it that way, we would be looking for specific improvements in other areas besides point source discharges, such as your treatment plant, namely non-point sources. So this is a concept that the coalition has talked about a little bit. Fred Short, who you may know, a scientist in UNH, has talked about a little bit, and several variations of this have floated around. So last week we talked to Exeter a little bit. It was an exploratory meeting, I guess is the way I would describe it. We're trying to see if where our interests lined up and if there was any made sense to talk about it further. And at that time, we certainly said that to the extent we can get cooperation, to the extent we can get more than one town to go forward under an approach like this, the more attractive it would be for us. The idea being maybe we can get some significant improvements quickly, which is of great interest to us because we don't think we have all the time in the world to begin to address this. So I guess this is sort of an invitation to sit down and talk about that subject a little bit. We wouldn't try to get it too deep into details, but just talk about some concepts and see if you're interested in developing that type of an approach further. We also have interests in neighboring communities where, for instance, Exeter has a treatment plant with capacity. If they would take in septic system hookups from other communities in the area. Does that make sense? That would be something of interest to us as well. So I think I'll stop there and just see if you have any questions about what I've just talked about, or if you wanted to send me in a different direction or have questions on something else.
Okay. Mr. Deloy, just for the record, could you state what your actual title is?
Yes.
Just so that we've got that for the record and the people at home know.
Yes, and I'll give you a card. I'm the New Hampshire State Director. I work in the Office of Ecosystem Protection.
Okay, thank you. Vice Chairman.
Thank you for coming tonight. I'm sure we all appreciate you really being here. I have a ton of questions, but I'll start with one, I think. Could you just explain for the people at home and for those of us here that don't exactly know what the permit process is? I mean, we all understand that Exeter has a draft permit.
Yes.
At what point in time does that become? I know it's open for discussion. You have comment period. At what point in time does that become etched in stone, if you will? And secondarily to that, is it typical for these permits to have time frames associated with them? In other words, if you have to meet 3 milligrams for nitrogen, do you have to do that in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, or?
Right. Well, the process, and now we've started it up in Exeter, so I'll just use that as an example. We proposed a draft permit, and you may find yourself in this situation shortly. When we prepared that draft permit and rather extensive fact sheet that goes along with it that explains the rationale behind how we set the limit. We typically meet with the town a little bit before we actually propose it in the Federal Register. So we sit down and maybe a few days before and talk to the town, tell them it's coming. We might be able to answer some questions at that point on the process. And then we go out to public notice. And the public notice process allows for 30 days public comment. However, that can be extended, and in the case of Exeter, because it was the first of 14 in this watershed that need permits, we actually had 120-day comment period, so it was much longer than the statutory minimum. And as a matter of fact, then we extended it a little bit further. There was some of the commenters had some problems with summer vacations or whatever, so we gave them a little bit more time. So now we have received all the comments, and let me back up a little bit. During that comment period, we typically hold a public meeting and a public hearing. So the public meeting is to explain a little bit about the permit, and the public hearing is just a formal opportunity for anyone that wants to stand up, make a statement, or submit a written comment, and we would take them at that time. And those same people or others could also submit written comments up until the comment period closes. In this case, I think it was last Friday that it actually closed. Then we take all those comments, typically we have a pile that's for it and a pile that's against it, and we sift through those, and we actually write out a response to every one of those comments. And the next step is to publish a final permit. Now, it could take an extended period of time to respond to those comments, and we have discretion there. So if we think that there's reason to continue a discussion, perhaps, or research information a little bit more to respond to comments, or any number of reasons, we don't have a deadline by which we have to come out with the final. So then we have a final permit out there, and those people that have commented on the permit, and in the case of Exeter, well, let me put that aside. I don't want to get too detailed here unnecessarily. But people have, commenters that commented on the draft permit have 30 days to file an appeal. The EPA, we don't agree with your decision. Those appeals go to an environmental appeals board, which is a panel of judges, administrative law judges within EPA. And they'll hear arguments and they'll take briefs. It's kind of like a court setting. Those that are appealing have their attorneys. We have ours. And we make our arguments, and the appeals board goes away for weeks, sometimes months. And they come back, and they say something to us. EPA was right. EPA was right in part. You weren't right. Go back and do it over again. So they have some latitude. Following that, you can go to court after that. And we haven't had too many of those. So that's the process, and it can be lengthy. It can take quite a bit of time. In some of the alternative approaches that we've been discussing, frankly, we'd like to short-circuit that appeal part of the process. We'd like to avoid it or short-circuit it. And any time during the appeals process, before you go before the EAB or even after, you could reach a settlement. And you could say, all right, EAB, we've agreed with the permittee, and we're gonna do it this way. And usually we can get concurrence on that. So that's sort of the process, and I think it's safe to say that Newmarket is coming up on time where we would calling you up and seeing if you wanted to sit down with us, and we would explain where we are in the permit process. Even before that, we'd be happy to sit down and talk about some of these alternative approaches that I mentioned earlier.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Bergeron.
Speaking of alternative approaches, you were saying that you'd be willing to discuss discharge limit adjustments if non-point source numbers were to improve, for instance, or those numbers were to improve. I guess my question is, since that seems to be about 70% of the nitrogen input seems to be non-point sources, correct me if I'm wrong on that, that's the numbers I've been told.
Well, I think those numbers are misleading.
Well, let me finish my sentence and, okay, and kind of clarify that also. What is the EPA doing to improve the non-point source numbers? Are you doing anything on that end of the spectrum? I know you're going after us with the water treatment plants, but the majority of it seems to be from elsewhere. So what are you doing on that front?
Well, our regulatory authorities do not reach to non-point sources. However, what you may think of as non-point source is actually a point source, and that is stormwater. So if you have a stormwater system and it's regulated, then we have some authority there. If it's not part of a stormwater system, if it's just runoff, if it's just fertilizer use on a golf course, for instance, that doesn't go into a stormwater, if it's runoff from a parking lot out here that just goes into the river, we don't have regulatory authority to go after that. Now, we do have a non-point source program that we fund and the state of New Hampshire administers, where we award funds to work on the problem. We're certainly interested in it and willing to work with communities on it. But what we don't have is authority that says you will do this, that, or the other. So that's where the limitation is in terms of non-point source and point source. So we have far more authority and an obligation under the Clean Water Act to write these permits. So now, is it 70%? I don't know how far we want to get into a discussion of the nitrogen inputs, but some of the best work has been done by UNH and in the Lamprey River watershed. And you can go online and look at Michelle Daly's presentations that are posted there and see what they've come up with after 10 or 15 years studying this particular watershed. What I will say is all nitrogen is not created equal, and the part that we're generally interested in is the result of human activity, and that is typically wastewater treatment plants, runoff from impervious surfaces, fertilizers, whether it be agricultural or lawn-type fertilizers. Septic tanks are big. And atmospheric deposition, which gets there by way of runoff, largely. Now, there's components of nitrogen, and the one that we're particularly interested in is the one that is very reactive in the environment. Okay, so this is the form of nitrogen that is like Miracle-Gro. And most of that comes from the wastewater treatment plants. Probably 50% of that type, dissolved inorganic nitrogen, comes from the treatment plant. So it's a very important component. Not only does it come from the treatment plant, but it goes directly by way of a discharge pipe into the waterway. So it's a direct shot in other words. We're pretty sure that we're going to see significant improvements from the control of treatment plants. But there certainly is a lot of other work that needs to be done in terms of the non-point sources and the point sources which comprise the stormwater systems, including septic tanks. And actually what we find in this watershed is that groundwater actually has more nitrate in it than surface water. And this is a problem for the future. Septic tanks and other sources of nitrogen are getting into the groundwater, and we can see a steady trend upwards. Another popular pollutant that we're seeing in your groundwater is chloride from road salt. And the reason I mention that is because that comes off of impervious surfaces as well, from winter de-icing. And that's another trend that you can look at, and that trend you can look at over 100 years, and you could see what's happening. Slowly but surely, it's rising up. Almost all of these are the product of increased population. There's some things we're not sure of in the estuary. One thing we're definitely sure of is the more people you have, the more nitrogen you have. It's a clear, undeniable line. So New Hampshire being the fastest growing state in New England, this being one of the fastest, if not the fastest growing areas in New Hampshire, people are coming and they're bringing their nitrogen with them. So really what we're talking about here is how we're going to adapt to a higher density here in the watershed than we've had in the past. And you can look at those statistics also. How many people per square kilometer? You can look at the census in terms of population growth. They think from 2000 to 2020, it's something like 65% increase here in this watershed. So what we're experiencing here is not anything more than what's being experienced many places across the country. More people, more of an impact, and we're certainly not going to solve this problem overnight, but we definitely have to look for more sustainable approaches so that we can accommodate those people. We're obviously not going to close the border and say, you know, no more people. So that's the real challenge for government and academics, and mostly, I think, private citizens, in terms of just how you behave and being aware of the impacts of increased population in a limited area and what that really means. So I don't want to go off too far on the soapbox here, but that really is what it's all about. More people in the same small area. So,
Councilor Bentley.
Two questions. When you were talking about the judges, did you say it's an EPA group of judges?
Yes.
Maybe that's why there's only been one appeal loss? I mean, that's silly to me. The foxes are guarding the chickens. There's been one appeal loss, and it's an EPA board of judges ruling against.
Well, let me say this. I can think of no reason why we would want to make the limit any more stringent than it absolutely has to be. And if you could tell me what the incentive for us to do that would be, I'd be interested in hearing it. The more restrictive the limit, the more people like me get beat up.
I don't know, as people like you, the second part of my question was to jump on what Councilor Bergeron said. You know, a lot of the people that have come to me, I can name three farms just that I know of in Lee that are on the Lamprey River, and there's cows that walk in the river, and they get, you know. So the taxpayers in small towns like Newmarket, I mean, this is unbelievable money we're talking about, up to $18 million. We don't have industry to help pay it. So all these people, the golf courses and the private homes on Smith Garrison and on each side of the, some beautiful homes there, and you can see Trulon and Chemlon out there doing it. And we had the folks that came, and forgive me, I don't remember who they, and did a presentation and talked about that they wanted more markers and more, see where it's really coming from. Put one 100 yards from the sewer treatment plant and 500 yards from the sewer treatment plant, put one out by Nanny's Island, put one out, because you go out in the bay, and I've lived on the bay, you know, grown up on the bay, and there's a lot of big, beautiful homes where nitrogen's coming right in. And there's farms from Raymond Epping on the Lamprey River, right on the river, that stuff's coming in. So I hope everyone's receptive to, you know, that sewer treatment plants is certainly a part of it, but there's a lot other, and it sounds like the town and the sewer users are going to foot the bill for everyone else. And I understand you don't have the authority to go up to Joe Smith and who's fertilizing his lawn, but it's like the towns are going to take the hit for everyone else gets a free pass, and that's really tough, you know, at the times we're in now, and it's really hard.
Yeah, lawns right up to the river, big, keeping, you know, four horses on an acre. That sort of stuff adds up. The septic tanks are a problem. They don't treat nitrogen very much at all. So we are interested in buffers for those rivers, and we've done a lot of work in that area when we can try to protect those through. Now, we don't have the authority, but you might have the authority to regulate something like that. There's also some ideas around that we've been working on for fertilizer that we hope will come to fruition, and that involves having the manufacturers develop a mix that doesn't have that much nitrogen. It has a slow release nitrogen, only as much as you need. So that might be a way of taking a look at that particular problem. But I agree that it's going to take more than the treatment plant, no doubt about it.
Councilman Nazaro, did you?
I did hit, didn't I?
Yeah, it went on and went off. I don't know why, but you're next. Go ahead.
Janice was sitting there last night for the veterans meeting. She was kicking it out, I think. I want to echo Vice Chairman
Butterman's welcoming you here. I appreciate you coming. I think that everyone here really, really shares your concern about the Great Bay. I mean, it's our own little local natural wonder. So I also want to echo what Councillor Bentley said, that there, and Councillor Bergeron as well, that non-point sources, I understand that the point sources are easy to go after, but non-point sources, not only is it the majority numerically, but I feel like that is a place that we could be working together, the town and the federal government. Since you don't have jurisdiction over non-point sources, I would much rather this felt like a true conversation where we could talk together about how to reduce total nitrogen in Great Bay as a whole through both non-point and perhaps point sources. But instead right now, and pardon the phrase, but this feels like you coming in saying you've only lost one appeal. The judges that we're going to work for the EPA, so it's kind of like the Yankees playing the Red Sox, but the Yankees get to be all the umps. And it feels like mafia government. It feels like we're coming in under a threat of we never lose, here's what we want. And maybe we can like argue for a 3 up to an 8, like, and that's what, there's a discussion around that. But I would much rather this was a healthy and two-way conversation about how total nitrogen within all of the Great Bay Estuary can be reduced, not just we're going to reduce non-point sources right now because they're the low-hanging fruit for the EPA to regulate, and then outside of that, we'll then talk about issues with total nitrogen from non-point sources. I just feel like we're going after the smallest amount first because it's the easiest to get at. And that doesn't seem to me to be, it just doesn't seem to be taking the, what into account, what I think the primary purpose of all this is to make sure the Great Bay is a healthy and flourishing ecosystem.
Well, I hear exactly what you're saying. Don't misconstrue my comments about the history of our permit writing, but I understood that you're about to make a decision on spending a significant amount of money to do a scientific investigation to refute what we have proposed. Again, we welcome additional data. This won't be the last of it, but that's the best way I can think of to put out for you what you're up against. Now, you could be sure if you or anyone else comes up with some scientific information that is valid, we'd be more than happy to lower the limit, but we just don't think that's going to happen. So I'm trying to give you both sides of it. And just one more time on the nitrogen from the wastewater treatment plants is the most significant source available for control, and it's also the cheapest and the one we're most sure about regulating. So when we begin to talk about the non-point sources, the lawns, the horses, the parking lots, conceptually we know that those could be controlled, but realistically we wonder, are we going to get ordinances put in place that actually make that happen? And how much is it going to cost? Those questions are very much open. The treatment plants, we know exactly what we're doing. We know the technology is there. We know basically how much it costs. And we know that that's the most reactive fraction, the most manageable portion of the nitrogen. So I just want to put those into context. It's not a small piece. It's a big piece. We would like to work with you on the overall problem. We think that working within sub-watersheds makes a lot of sense, because what you're doing here and what Portsmouth is doing are very different because of where they're situated and where they are in the process. They're in the process of going from primary treatment to secondary treatment. And the conditions where they, and I'm not sure they are even certain where they're going to discharge yet, the conditions there are much different. So if we can look at the lamprey, or if we can look at the Exeter Squamscott, it becomes more manageable. All the inputs are coming from that sub-watershed into those tributaries, and we can begin to look at point sources and non-point sources in a way that we think makes sense. And if you get the individual sub-watersheds in order, then the overall watershed will follow.
Can I ask one follow-up to that?
Sure.
So you really believe that you truly that if the nitrogen levels are lower, transparency will be increased and the eelgrass will come back. That's really what this all is about, right? Saving the eelgrass?
No. Eelgrass is an early indicator of a problem because it's very sensitive to changes. In the case of nitrogen in the permit process in New Hampshire, there is no numeric criteria. The state has developed some draft criteria, and we think they've done some great work. And we've had that reviewed by experts, okay, outside of EPA, professors that have countless publications on this, literally hundreds, and they think they did a good job. So without numeric criteria, what we do is we consider a whole host of indicators, and whether it's phytoplankton, chlorophyll A, whether it's eelgrass, whether it's limits that have been set by others in other estuaries, reports that have come out of NOAA, for instance, reports that have come out of our own estuary program here, which has been monitoring and studying for years. And we take all that and look at it. Now, when we look at the lamprey, we see a lot of nitrogen in the river. The median value is 0.45 milligrams per liter, which is higher than the criteria that the state is trying to get to. And the range at some time approaches 1 milligram per liter. So we're pretty sure there's too much nitrogen in that river. And we think that under the regulations and under the law, the limit that we propose will be the one that's legally defensible. So it's not just about eelgrass. It's about the sum total of indicators, information, and studies that have been done that leads us to this conclusion. And we think there's far too much nitrogen in the river.
And so the eelgrass is like the canary in the cave, sort of the the first sign that something.
Yes, the first signs.
So, and I know you said that a lot of professors have studied this, and included you, Professor Short was one of the ones that you mentioned.
Professor Short has also, and I can give you references for a professor from Cornell and a second professor that reviewed the work that was done by the state.
So I'm sure people at home may not have seen this, but we've had the opportunity to see it. I'm sure you've seen it. The Great Pay Municipal Coalition's comments on the proposed Exeter permit.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I haven't read them.
So
I did receive them.
Would it be surprising to you if it said that Professor Short was backing up the idea that for total nitrogen to affect transparency, it must cause increased and excessive chlorophyll A levels? The historical data evaluations presented for the Great Bay confirm that average algae growth increases have been slight and therefore could not have been the underlying cause for the eelgrass decline occurring throughout the system. So if Professor Short is perhaps saying that maybe more investigation is required, would the EPA listen to that argument?
Well, we're going to listen to everyone who commented on it, including these comments, and we're not only going to listen to them, we're going to write out written responses to them. So our position will be well known by you and anyone else that wants to give a critical review of it. I don't want to speak for Professor Short. I guess what he would probably say is that the Great Bay is a shallow estuary, and light is not a huge problem out there, and that macroalgae is probably one of the seaweed is one of the things that are most threatening. But it is hard to argue that when the nitrogen levels are already as high as they are, that you can then add more to it. And I don't think anyone would question that this is a growing load of nitrogen. So But we will respond to those individually, and you'll be able to read our response.
I'll give the other councilors.
Councilor Zink.
I have a question and a request. The question is specifically, which is the seat that we're sitting in now. If you were a citizen of Newmarket, would you support this study being done?
Well, I'm not going to answer that. How about the request?
And you're not.
Answer it.
Because why?
Well, I think that.
I mean, that's what the people at home are asking us to do.
Right. And I think that, fortunately or unfortunately, it is your decision. I think I've been pretty strong in my opinion that we think we know what we're doing here. And we're going to be surprised if new information surfaces that makes us change our mind. But I don't feel comfortable telling you, don't spend the money. And we have been criticized for that.
For
suggesting that the money shouldn't be spent.
The request is, and again, you obviously know the science, I don't. But we've had the opportunity to be presented with some of the EPA's comments regarding the science. We've had an opportunity to review the consultants' arguments for the science. And the science is the science in many of the cases that the consultant quotes. Up is up and down is down. And my request to you is, would you be willing, if we do move ahead with this project, to come back with the consultant here and talk to us about why one another's conclusions are incorrect?
Well, I'm probably not the right person to do that, because I'm not a water quality expert or an estuarine scientist. But let me say this, that I can guarantee you that a limited amount of sampling and some amount of modeling is not going to answer all your questions, is not going to be conclusive. It's going to give you some measure of knowledge. It may even raise more questions than it answers. Then you get to do more work. And that's the nature of these types of investigations. You do a little bit of work. You try to understand what you've just done. And then you do some more. And as I mentioned earlier, the UNH scientists that have spent their entire careers, they're still out there every day trying to answer some of the questions that go to the heart of how the estuary works.
Last follow-up?
Sure.
I'm going to re-ask the question again. You said you weren't the specialist, but you must have a specialist on your team. And what the people in Newmarket, I can tell you the council, what the people at Newmarket want is we don't want a battle. We want a presentation of the best thoughts from the EPA, best thoughts from our consultant, and believe it or not, I think the citizens of Newmarket will be able to sort it out themselves. Mm-hmm. When they listen to a proposal A that says the science is A, and the other side says, no, the science is not A, it's B, we will be able to figure it out. And I would just like the courtesy of not a notice, not a handwritten, this is our, I'd like the courtesy of somebody from the EPA who does have the capability and are consulting, making a presentation to the taxpayers about the science.
Well, in the case of Newmarket, we're going to write down our rationale and give it to you.
Excuse me, sir, that isn't what I asked for. I asked for somebody from the EPA coming in and presenting so that questions may be asked. I don't think it's appropriate just to get a written report for it. I mean, I think the citizens deserve to listen to both sides.
Well, how about if we consider that? And
Well, I'll take that as a no.
Well, you know, I don't want to agree to something that I'm not sure is going to be productive. And the science quickly gets to the point where it's difficult to understand. What isn't difficult to understand is 8 years of monitoring on the Lamprey River and what that tells us about how much nitrogen is in the river. So I don't know if I can deliver a scientific debate for the town, but I'm not saying we won't do it. I'm not sure it makes sense, but we will consider it.
Just one last follow-up. I'm not asking for a debate. That's not what this is all about. This is all about taking a point in science and having person A and person B present their point of view. It's not a debate. Thank you. And I also, by the way, thank you for coming.
It's my pleasure.
Mr. Malowski.
You talk about the Lamprey has been extensively studied, the watershed itself. Newmarket's at the end of that watershed. What have you seen for characteristics upstream that are causing, you know, a significant nitrogen level in our area? And what are you doing about, you know, the communities further upstream in limiting their nitrogen levels?
Well, again, I think some of the best study that's been done has been done by UNH, and it's ongoing right now. This is kind of their laboratory, this watershed, and they're doing a lot of good work to characterize those non-point sources. It's a very interesting investigation, as a matter of fact, and most of the nitrogen inputs to this watershed never reach the bay. It's in the 80%, 85%, I believe, is retained somehow in the watershed, and the mechanisms are not fully understood, and that's one of the things that UNH is studying. Now, the good news is that this watershed is particularly good at retaining that nitrogen and not allowing it to get into the bay. Some of it is being retained, and some of it we think might be recycled into the atmosphere. The bad news is there may be a point at which it can't hold back anymore. The groundwater builds up to a point, or the vegetation available can no longer hold back anymore, and you might have a significant increase. And we do see other watersheds where this retention is not as great. But septic tanks. Most of the nitrogen falls in the watershed comes from atmospheric deposition. That gets back into the water through runoff. Manure, and by manure, I would include what we traditionally think of as manure, pet waste, you name it. Canadian geese, I don't know. Those are some of the big ones. Certainly storm water that's collected and discharged is going to have a nitrogen component. Wastewater treatment plant is, again, probably the most significant single source. So impervious surface, septic tanks, runoff, those are the culprits, and I think it will take a long-term effort. So now what we've been talking about is maybe we don't have to go to the limit right away. Maybe we start off with a limit that's less than that stringent limit and give the town an opportunity to work on some of these other problems and see what type of progress can be made in those areas and put off that lower limit. And if somehow the problem can be solved without getting to that limit, there might be a way to avoid ever having to go there. What we can't do is write a permit again that we don't think is legally defensible, and so we have to have that stringent limit in the permit. This type of an alternative approach would have to be outlined in a separate agreement and worked on that way. And I don't want to have this sound like this is something easy to do. We would be moving into an area that we don't have experience with, and we would have to go slowly. And I'm not sure it would work, quite frankly, but we're willing to try. We're willing to do something other than just give you the permit and say we never lose, and you know, you're stuck with it.
I'd like to weigh in just before Councilor Bentley goes for a second time. I'm trying to put myself as a counselor in a situation where the people that are watching this evening and reading about it in the newspapers get a good understanding as to how we're spending their money, how we're sitting up here and spending upwards of $18 million. And my biggest concerns from what I've heard this evening and what I've heard bits and pieces over the last several weeks is, in theory, if as a council we do nothing, then we've given you an opportunity to set the limit wherever you feel is adequate. With really nothing, no one up here is going to be able to give you the scientific data that's going to go against something that you're presenting to us. So that's a concern that I think I have, and perhaps the majority of the citizens that are going to be paying for this. Obviously, you know, based on the track record where, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that this is a situation where you have full control over everything, but based on your track record, as you've stated, if we spend this money to do this study, this is ill-spent money. This is a waste of money, and based on the fact that you've realistically only lost one time. And that concerns me because, once again, we're being asked to spend taxpayer money, or user money would be the proper term probably on this. And the last thing I'd like to say is I'm just a little bit bothered because Councilor Zinks made a good point, and I don't think we want to get into a debate. This isn't a us against them situation that I'm looking at. This is more of what can Newmarket do to lower their costs down the road, to take the burden off from the users, and, you know, how can we justify that we're spending $18 million as opposed to potentially $13 million if the levels are set differently. So it's not really a debate. It's just that I think we're looking for someone to come back and say what, and you've kind of touched on it briefly this evening where you've said you've done this for 7 years and we're looking at somebody to do this over an 8-week period, maybe, I think is the proper duration of this study that they're looking to do. So obviously you have a lot more data than what we're going to gather in 8 weeks, but you know, it's just the thought that we can spend a very small amount of money to potentially save a lot of money if there's willing to be compromised, or if there's willing to, you know, seriously consider what's being put to the EPA from this particular study. So, I mean, that's really, you know, the only points that I've got is none of us up here have the qualifications that you do or that the people that are going to do this study. We have to rely on what you're telling us, and it becomes difficult when it's potentially $18 million that we're going to spend.
So. Well, let me say this, that we are impressed that you're considering spending this amount of money. Given the times we're in, and I live in Plastow, and it's not easy to come up with, I don't even know what your share is, but I understood it was over $100,000, so we're very impressed that you're willing to put that money up at the local level, and we certainly will look at the data. There's no, we'll give it full consideration. There's no doubt about that. And we're not so so bold as to think we could never be wrong. We just doubt whether this amount of information is going to change our minds and cause us to go in a different direction. I mean, that's as fair as I can present it. I don't know how else to say it. Now, of course, in the case of Newmarket, we haven't even proposed anything yet, so it's a little bit different, but we'll certainly look at the work that's done if you decide to go in that direction. And as I said, this won't be the last work done either. As a matter of fact, we have some sampling going on this week as well out in the Squamscott River. And so data is going to continue to be collected, and we're going to continue to study the estuary, and we're going to continue to try to understand it. In the meantime, we're going to put out a permit that we think meets the requirements of the Clean Water Act, and beyond that, we're willing to sit down with you and see if there's some other formula that we can work with that gets us to meeting water quality standards under an alternative approach. Even though I can't articulate that tonight, we're willing to begin the discussion, and we did begin the discussion with Exeter in a very general way last week.
Thank you. Councilor Bentley?
In the interest of trying to keep it under an hour here, couple real quick things. I think if you sat as an outsider or someone new to this and saw the presentation, I think that's all Councilor Zink is saying. There was slides and all kinds of infoil, and it was a lot of infoil.
Did you understand it?
And it was confusing, but I learned a lot. I took away a lot that I didn't know then. And I think that's all he's saying, is it would be neat to see slides and terminology and other things other than we have a limit. I brought up earlier, and then our administrator brought up, you know, we're at the other end of the Lamprey. So Pawtuckaway, where it comes from, and Raymond and Eppin, yes, we could try to make some ordinances here, and I don't know how we could pass them and regulate them, you know, have the tree warden look and see who's using fertilizer, but you know, to be serious, we can't control Raymond, Epping, Lee, Durham, you know, so we're at the end of it. I'd love to see some type of a study done, and I think you said there's some info already, but I'd love to see what the nitrogen level is right before it goes over the waterfall into the, I'd like to see what it is, because I go down Lee Hook Road and you see three farms where cows are right in the water, and that can't be helping whether 80% of it stays there or not. There's still 20% coming. And the last thing I have in a two-sentence answer, so what if nitrogen is high? If we don't really care about eelgrass, it's an indicator. If nitrogen is high, too high, what does it do?
Well, what you'll see is a continual decline in the estuary itself. This eutrophication, this nutrient enrichment, in the case of the estuary, nitrogen is usually the culprit. In freshwater, phosphorus is usually the culprit. So if you are familiar with some of the smaller lakes around that are now turning bright green at this time of year, that's a change in that aquatic system, a result of eutrophication, over-enrichment. In fact, on my way here, just outside of the center of Exeter, on the left-hand side is the backyard pond, I think is the name of it, and I saw it tonight, and it was bright green. I assume it's cyanobacteria, which is, you don't want to have exposure to that. In fact, you don't even want your pet to be exposed to it. In an estuary, you'll see a steady decline in the available oxygen. You'll see nuisance algae begin to take over. So the types of life that were predominant when the estuary was healthy will begin to disappear and be replaced. The habitat, two-thirds of the commercial fishery in the United States, those fish have some of their life stage within the estuary. So it's sort of like a nursery in and around the eelgrass. You could begin to have smell. If you've ever been at a seashore with rotting seaweed high on the shore, that's the type of fish kills. Everywhere you look in this country where there's estuaries, there's either the first signs of this problem or the final stages of it. In the Gulf of Mexico, where it's rather extreme, they call them dead zones in the ocean. There's virtually no life there, and they're huge. These aren't small areas. I would recommend to you all an urgent call to action. You can Google this, urgent call to action in nitrogen, and you'll come up with a document that was put together by a task force comprised of states and EPA. It's a little dated, a few years old, but it explains the problem of excessive nutrients. And this is not only estuaries, this is drinking water as well. This is groundwater, it's drinking water. And that document outlines the scope of the problem across the country, and you wouldn't believe how widespread it is. And a lot of it dates back to a technique for creating nitrogen, manufacturing it, that never existed. I believe it was in the 50s it was come up with, and you could see from that point on this problem just shoots right up. And I recommend that document to try to get an overall feel for this and see that it's a problem that's way bigger than Newmarket or Exeter. And you know, I think there towns do need help in this area. Obviously, this is a time of small government being popular, so I'm not sure it's going to be any help coming from our direction anytime soon, but maybe that'll change in years to come when the problem matures. I don't know. But it does seem to be tailor-made for some help that the towns could use in solving this problem.
If I could, councilors, if you want to, I've got some lights on, but one more question. We'll try to wrap this up so Mr. Deloy can get home this evening. Councilor Bergeron.
Mr. Deloy, just to back up a little bit, you mentioned that you might be conducive to a multi-step approach for setting discharge limits depending on the district. I mean, I guess like monitoring the river, I guess, is, you were saying 85% of the nitrogen is absorbed by the Lamprey watershed before it hits the bay. That being said, we're currently looking at doing a dam removal study for our downtown dam by the mill. Mm-hmm. That's on the Lamprey River. My concern with that would be if we were to remove that dam and change that watershed entirely, could that negatively impact our nitrogen input into the bay, or the nitrogen input in general into the bay? Could we be shooting ourselves in the foot by doing that, in your opinion?
I do not know the answer to that. I hesitate to speculate. Well, there are problems with taking down dams sometimes because of what's behind the dam.
Well, my concern, I guess, just to kind of finish my thought, was if 85%, you were saying roughly 85% of the nitrogen seems to be getting absorbed somehow, you're not quite sure, before it hits the bay, by significantly changing the watershed, we may have, you know, killed the golden goose. If all of a sudden we change that watershed, now a lot more nitrogen's hitting that bay. You know, that's a concern.
I don't think those two are related. There may be other problems with the dam, but I don't. The absorption that we see, we're assuming, is in vegetation and other buffer areas.
But that's an impoundment that's huge, and it has a lot of vegetation on it that could be absorbing. These are thoughts that I'm.
It's affecting.
It could be affecting it. I would seriously consider that before we move further with that. One final thought, and I believe you mentioned Michelle Daly from UNH. I'm on the Conservation Commission, and she, I've been talking about putting together a talk for the councilors, and she is the person who would be giving us the talk. So I highly recommend that we continue. I know that it's being done on our end, but that you do go to that meeting, because all these questions could probably be asked of her as well. But that's my final thoughts. Thank you.
Yeah, she's done several presentations for us, and she has a way of presenting information that makes it understandable. And I believe they've been in this watershed for 10 or 15 years. So it's a good source.
Mr. Chairman.
All right. I could think, from my perspective, to summarize what I think I've heard, and I was one of the councils that supported doing the study. I think from what I've heard, if I had to vote again on it, I'd say no, basically because it seems like there's so much information that EPA already has that whatever study we do in 2 months is not going to be enough evidence to change the situation. I think the money would be better spent trying to work with coming up with different permit conditions or time frames that are more palatable to do things in stages, or to try to address some of the other issues that we can internally, you know, town stormwater management issues, things like that, that might be better spent from. I think what I heard is if we spend this money that we're going to waste. And furthermore, I think what I heard was that with the system of appeals and everything, and I think that if we chose to pursue it, we'd just end up in court spending hundreds of thousands of dollars or millions of dollars trying to fight something that, I mean, we're not experts on it. We'd have a tough time, I think, changing, like Mr. Deloy said, I think we'd have a tough time changing EPA stance on it. So if we had to vote again, I think I'd change my mind and say no.
What's that?
Yes.
Councilor Zink.
I appreciate learning more about the process. I didn't understand it as completely as I did in terms of the permitting process. I thank you for that. You asked a question of Councilor Bentley a few moments ago, and the question was, did you understand the presentation? And I want to reiterate, I didn't know jack about it, but I know more about it now than I did before. It was very informative. I never got above a B in science, so probably not the best guy to do it. But yes, the fact of the matter is I learned a lot about it. And I think it is a sad state of affairs, a very sad state of affairs, when, and I'm not speaking to you, but I'm speaking to the EPA, cannot commit that they would send a representative to explain to the community why there is a differing opinion. I think it's absurd. The paychecks for the EPA come from the citizens, and yet the EPA isn't willing to commit to come talk to the citizens about the science. I think we're smart enough to understand some of it, and I think there are a whole lot of folks at home that would like to see that, would like to, and for a governmental agency to say, we're not going to come talk to you, I don't get it. But thank you for coming.
Well, I can't let you leave it on that. We will certainly explain, come up, do a presentation. We'll have a public meeting when your permit comes up, and we'll have a presentation there to explain it. We could bring a scientist up here to speak with you and the council. What we don't want to get into is a debate with a consultant over the science. We're not sure that that's the best way to sort through the information. And there's a lot to this.
I really would just follow is. Up, and then I'll shut my mouth. I don't think it's up to EPA to decide whether a debate is appropriate or not. I think it's up to the citizens to decide whether they'd like to hear it or not. I think that closing the door on one side of it because we don't think it's appropriate. You work for us.
Right.
I won't say anymore. Thank you.
Any other councilors that haven't?
Yeah, my light's broken.
Oh, or you did it.
That is, I know, I am so boring. I have a comment I just want to make, but before I say that, you said the era of small government is like upon us or something, but apparently the government's big enough to tell us what to do, just not big enough to give us the money to back it. So, Mr. Federal Government. So, again, I want to thank you for coming. I know that we've sat here lambasting you for a while, so apparently you've suffered these slings and arrows before, it sounds like it. I really want to thank you for saying that you want to engage in a discussion around a phased approach, or some sort of way to mitigate what any cost would be to citizens and taxpayers of Newmarket. I just hope that we could begin that discussion before the permit situation, because it sounds like you're talking with Exeter right now, but their permit's there. They know how much total nitrogen they're allowed to put out of their point source. I would rather that we could continue conversing to come up with a way that through federal point source regulations and local non-point source maybe efforts, we could come up with a way to reduce total nitrogen in the bay, if that truly is where the science is showing that's causing the problem. I also just want to say, just to close it, that I'm interested to hear when you do read the Great Bay Municipal Coalition's comments on the proposed Exeter permit, I'd really be interested to hear what EPA's retort is to that, because it's using EPA's data and coming up with, I think, very different conclusions than what you're coming up with. So, because at the end, what it comes down to is the eelgrass is dying. The canary in the cave is going out, and there's a reason behind it, and if it's not total nitrogen and something else, I really want to know what that is, because it's our backyard that's being affected. So, thank you very much.
That's it.
That's it.
Okay, that's it, Mr. Deloy.
Deloy,
I'm sorry. I was going to do that again. I appreciate you attending this evening. I respect your honesty and your insight, and I thank you from the council for showing up this evening.
Thank you very much.
So my pleasure, and we will address those comments, and if they contain something we weren't aware of, we'll be happy to admit that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilors, good discussion on that. As I stated, agenda item number 2 is off this evening. So now we're at number 3, presentation of petitions and resolutions. We have first resolution is resolution 2011-2012-04, resolution relating to the town's payoff of the Public Works Fire Rescue Squad building liability over the next 10 years. And I'll read the resolution. Whereas the town of Newmarket voted to bond the construction of a new Public Works Fire Rescue Squad building in May 2004 for $1,600,000. And whereas deficiencies were discovered after said vote that prevented the town council from moving forward with issuing a bond for said construction. And whereas the town moved forward with the construction by utilizing general fund surplus without an appropriation by the voters, which created a liability against the surplus. And whereas the town council undertook a repayment by appropriating $120,000 in the annual town budget, bringing the outstanding balance to $1,360,000. And whereas the town council wishes to complete the payoff of said liability over 10 years through annual appropriations of $136,000 until paid in full. And whereas the annual appropriation will have the beneficial effect of slowly eliminating this liability, which reduces the available surplus funds and to rebuild the surplus account over the coming years. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Newmarket Town Council does hereby direct the town administrator to include $136,000 in the annual town budget, payments to bond and notes, until such time as the liability is eliminated. Given at the Town Council Chambers, Newmarket, New Hampshire, the 17th day of August in the year of our Lord, 2011. A look for a motion. Vice Chairman.
Make a motion to approve Resolution 2011-2012-04.
I'll second that.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, I'll ask Mr. Winowski for the vote.
Counselor Bentley?
Aye.
Counselor Bergeron?
Aye.
Counselor Zink?
Aye.
Counselor Nazaro?
Aye.
Counselor Bodiman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 6-0. Next one, Mr. Winowski, was there a public hearing on this one for the purchase of the expedition?
Nope, we did not.
So do we want to hold this for
yes.
the next?
Yep.
So we're down with that. Moving on to agenda item number 4, Town Council to consider appointments to committees, commissions. Vice Chairman.
Make a motion that we appoint. I'll nominate Michelle Daly to the Lamprey River Advisory Committee for a term that expires in 2014.
Second.
Any discussion? Any other nominations? Seeing none, Mr. Winowski, I'll ask for the vote.
Counselor Bentley?
Aye.
Counselor Bergeron?
Aye.
Counselor Zink?
Aye.
Counselor Nazaro?
Aye.
Counselor Bodiman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 6-0. Next is a review of minutes from Standing Committee and Council Representatives. CIP, we met, was it last Thursday?
Yes.
A week ago, tomorrow we met. We're starting with the wastewater water treatment, trying to get that taken care of, but it's still in the very early stages, so I suspect that within the next, probably next meeting, I'll have more information for you, at least in reference to that. So that's all I have on that. And Councilor, Vice Chairman Bodiman for Planning Board.
Last Planning Board meeting, we went through a discussion on proposed new stormwater management regulations, which in Newmarket are severely outdated. It looks like we're in a comment period whereby Planning Board members are making final comments to the proposals, but what has been a gaping hole in our regulations is that basically there has been no requirement for stormwater management unless you met the state threshold. So if this gets approved, which I believe it will, there will be stormwater management required for projects. I don't remember the exact numbers, but I think it's above 20,000 square feet, which is a huge step forward as far as helping to mitigate runoff from newly developed sites. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Bergeron, Conservation Commission?
I was unable to attend the last Conservation Commission meeting. However, as I previously mentioned, we are trying to set up a discussion with Michelle Daly to discuss with the Conservation Commission, you know, members of the community and the council, to discuss the nitrogen and its impact on Great Bay. I think in light of tonight's discussion, I'd also like to perhaps talk about non-point sources and how we may be able to impact that at the local level. Like everyone's saying, you know, you can go to Aubuchon Hardware and buy all the fertilizer that you want, spread it on your yard and have at it. We're spending millions of dollars to mitigate nitrogen out of our waste treatment plant. Now, you know, maybe it isn't apples to apples as far as the types of nitrogen, but however, you know, I do see Chem Lawn and all the lawn services going throughout the community as well, and you know, I wonder about that myself. And you know, I also wonder how we would ever be able to enforce such a thing. But I know there's also, you know, we are now, you know, federally protected wetlands, and now that Lamprey is a scenic river, and that changed the buffer zone on the edge of the river, and also, you know, maybe there is a way of enforcing this that's in our court. So I think that's a discussion that we really need to have at this point. So that being said, that's it for
Council. Do you have any idea when Ms. Daly is going to be presenting?
In an email today, I believe it was August 30th and some early dates of September.
So it hasn't been set as of this?
It has not. I had mentioned it here before, and I think in discussion with the council, it was up to us, the Conservation Commission, to set that date. But if anybody has a date that works, then it certainly would help.
Well, I would encourage you to let Ms. Winowski or myself know as soon as, I guess from this point, let the Conservation Commission have it work their schedule, and then we'll...
I think this is more important than ever, that we educate ourselves on this subject.
Right. Thank you.
Yep.
Councilor Nazaro, Black Bear and Highway Public Safety.
There hasn't been a Black Bear meeting since our last workshop, because there wasn't a quorum available. So the next meeting is August 25th, next Thursday. For members of the public, come on down.
Okay, nothing on Highway Public Safety?
No.
Councilor Zink, Budget Committee.
We have not met. We are getting our rigorous... The chair is getting our rigorous schedule set up for the school and the town in terms of starting on the school budget. But they are yet to be scheduled.
Right, but there is one meeting scheduled, if I'm not mistaken, that includes both the town and the school with the Budget Committee?
There is. And...
September 27th.
September, I'm sorry, there is one meeting. Thanks for reminding us. It's September 27th?
Yes.
And the purpose of that meeting is to discuss with the school and with the town some basic parameters for next year's budgeting. It's the first time it's been done. I think it's a really good effort to get the school and the town with the same kinds of considerations of operating budget increases and so forth. So that is scheduled. That should be a very good and helpful meeting. Thanks for reminding me.
Thank you. Councilor Bentley, Energy Committee.
I got to catch up with Chairman Bourne. I believe there was one 2 weeks ago. I was on nights for a couple different weeks, off and on, and I did not attend it. But I don't see minutes in here. So either they had it and they weren't minutes, or they didn't have it. Anyway, I need to catch up, get caught up.
All right, that takes care of that item. Item six, continuation of charter review. Okay.
Have something to pass out? Two things, actually. What's being passed around is we had the discussion on two areas of Article 2, the first being Section 2.9 display. Now, the first one is 2.8, contested elections. On the back of the handout that I provided you, Becky Venuti provided me a copy of the law, RSA 669:36, relative to tie votes. And it outlines what it is, and rather than sort of referencing the RSA, what I did is I copied the language of the RSA and put it in, because okay. You notice in the language we currently have, it says that the election shall be determined in a manner as decided by the town clerk in the presence of the tied candidates. Well, what happens if one of the candidates decides he or she isn't going to go to the meeting? You know, does that prevent her from doing it? So therefore, what I did was struck the sentence that references that and put, in the case of a tie at any town election, the winner shall be determined by lot by the town clerk in the presence of the candidates who are tied, if upon notice from him they elect not to be present. So if a person wants to be there, they can. If they decide they don't want to be, the town clerk can continue on with determining who the winner is going to be. And the second...
Can we just...
Sure.
Councilors, any questions on this particular one or anything that... Any concerns? Okay. Good.
Okay.
Next.
And the second one is Section 2.9, display of campaign material at polling places. You have a copy of RSA 659:43, which talks about the moderator's responsibility in setting up a corridor but also talks about, you know, what can be provided to people and where it can't be. And basically, I changed the current language, and quickly I'll read it. It says, the moderator shall exercise his power under state law relative to the conduct of elections. And then I added a sentence or a couple words. It says, and the distribution of campaign materials and electioneering within the polling place as provided by RSA 659:43. So I sort of separated the sentence by saying that, you know, the moderator exercises power under state law as the conduct of the election, but also under 659:43, he sort of oversees the type of distribution of campaign material and electioneering within the polling place. So I think that sort of clarifies it a little bit more, that if people have a question, it also gives them a reference that they can go and check out on election day if they have some concerns. Those are the two that were outstanding that the council had asked that I look at and come back with information. And if I can find the piece of paper quickly. Ms. Benvenuti also indicated to me that she has been in touch with Dave Scanlon, who's the Assistant Secretary of State, to ensure that what we're proposing to do relative to the polling hours, 7 to 7 for all elections except the presidential, and the 7 to 8 for presidential with a 30-day notice, is acceptable in accordance with the state law, and she's awaiting a response from him. So I'll have some further information as we go forward on that.
Okay. Any questions from councilors? Are we all good with these changes at this point? Okay. Mr. Manofsky, is it possible to get this up on the website? I'd like to see it on Channel 13, but I think when you get things like this on Channel 13, it's so small you really can't see it. But what I'd really like to see is almost like a split screen on the website where you'd see the old Section 2 of the charter,
yep,
and then the new, so that people have a chance, and then maybe, you know, in the next 30 days or something, we can have a public hearing on it if there is anybody that has any concerns or you know, wants to discuss it.
I'll talk to Doug and see what we can work up on that.
Yeah, I think it would be great if we could have a split screen and have it that way so you see what it was before and what we're proposing. And I guess, you know, if for practical reasons, I think the council is done with Article 2, am I correct? So where do we want to go next? What do we want to attack next? If
three's the big one, right?
Article 3? You guys ready for a lot of extra meetings?
I guess to sort of help you, if you noticed on the paperwork that I handed out tonight, I put a box around that area that at least from my perspective, mm-hmm, I recommended to the council consider changing, so I think it's a little bit easier to notice what it is. You see the current language and what's being proposed, and hopefully that might make it easier for the council.
Councilor Nazaro.
Is it just my read of this is that Article 6 is the one that like sort of started this conversation, like way back when we were setting our goals. It was personnel policies, whether or not the part of the charter was in agreement with federal law and this and that. Maybe that, since that's like sort of where we started this conversation, perhaps that's where we should go next after Article 2 here is complete. Just a suggestion. That is my.
Yeah, there's four sections in that. Is that what we want to try to tackle? No? I'm sorry. Councilor Bergeron.
Well, this is actually a comment from Councilors Inc. It was whispering to me as well, but I think we had set some goals as far as what we wanted to attack first, I believe, earlier in the year. That being said, I also believe that we've gone through Section 2, found a number of issues. I can't see why we wouldn't just continue to roll on and at least cast our eye on everything as we go through. If we don't have an issue, we can just keep moving on. We quickly get to Section 6 instead of skipping around in the charter.
answer that.
Well, not so much an answer, but I think that the benefit of doing it consistently, going each chapter each, is that, you know, you make changes, and then I think globally the council may want to look at it and say, if we put all this before the residents or the voter at one election, this might be too much, but what we really see are some problem areas is this article here and this article here and this article, and let's put those forward, and next year we'll come back, you know, with some more changes. Because I think in the end we would see a ballot that's probably 4 pages long, and this might become confusing.
All right, we got some discussion going on here. Councilor Zink.
Yeah. I was just quickly. Yes, sir. If you look at the council's goals for this year, are not in any particular order, but the charter was one of the goals. To try to get the same voting day for the school and the town was the second goal. To take advantage of any town/school consolidations that we may be able to take advantage of. And it was number 4, personnel policies.
Update personnel policies to ensure compliance with state and federal law. And that was update the policy itself, which Julie Glover is working on. Yes. That is
our fourth goal.
Yes.
Okay. My only concern is it's an awful lot to do. I don't know if we'll get up to number 6, but by not getting up to 6, will that preclude us from accomplishing that goal?
No. Because you're looking at the personnel policy, which is the manual that all employees receive when they begin work here, and deals with everything from holidays, vacation time, you know, restrictions, you know, benefits, this type of.
Okay, let me ask you this question, Mr. Winowski, if I may. If we change the personnel policy, if Ms. Glover comes back with recommendations for us to change the personnel policy, do we in fact have to go through Article 6, which is personnel policies, and change those in accordance?
Can I see that, please?
Sure. Okay. So I guess that's kind of what I understand.
With the question
yeah,
is.
And, you know, I would so love to go into Section 3, because I think that's the big one to crack. But once again, if we're doing, you know, if Ms. Glover's doing the policy now, working on it, in order for us to really change it, we may have to.
Well, if you look at 6.2, it says a personnel plan. It says the plan shall include provisions with regards to classification, compensation, selection, training, promotion, grievances, discipline, vacations, retirement, and other matters necessary to the maintenance of the efficient service and proper working conditions. That's not going to preclude the council.
There's really nothing in Article 6 that specifies a certain part of the personnel policy. Okay. It just, in essence, tells you that you have to have all these things within your personnel policy.
Is a goal that one be established for all the employees, and they know what the rules and regulations. And
so that may very well be an article that doesn't need any changing. It's just a subset, which is the actual policy itself, which is currently being worked on, and which I would hope we would have by the first of the year. Yes. Ed, Mr. Winowski?
No, I'm all set.
You're all set. Councilor Bentley?
Well, I agree with going in order. I think what we talked about is we knew we wouldn't get through the whole thing by the election, and I think the chairman had said, or someone had said, if there's ones you're passionate about and want them for that election, just you know, and I'll just go back to my favorite one is the pay, the $1,500 stipend or zero stipend. You know, I'm definitely going to wave a flag and say I'd really like to see that before the next election, but I think we should go to 3 to 4 to 5, and unless someone has one specific, hey, I'd like to jump ahead to 8.2 because blank, and do that.
Vice Chairman?
I think we can get the personnel policies changed whether or not we change Chapter 6, because it's vague enough. But having said that, we're 3 months into the year already, and we haven't seen anything on the personnel policy, and I'm sure that will take a lot of discussion, so I would like to suggest that we get an update from Ms. Glover.
Coming tonight.
Update in the
packet.
The packet. And basically, this is what it says. It is from Ms. Glover.
Go ahead.
Personnel policy update. Work is progressing on complete revision to the town's personnel policy manual. Draft is still scheduled for attorney review in September. Reviewed policies from other towns have spoken with the town administrator and human resource personnel and their likes and dislikes regarding their own policies. Those are administrators and human resource people in other communities.
My point is, though, don't we want to see those before they go out to attorney review and everything? And see them in piecemeal? I would, because we're gonna make our comments, and after we make our comments and we see it the way we're written, then that's the time to send it to the attorney.
Well, all we have to do is...
But that's digressing, but...
Okay, if I might just add something to that. I believe the discussion was we originally had Ms. Glover present some changes to us 6 months ago, maybe, to which there were a lot of changes, and we were just going back and forth. And I really thought at that time it was the council's wishes to have Ms. Glover present us basically the finished product, which to me would mean it goes through legal to see if it passed that test, give it to the council as legal has approved it, and then if the council has any concerns or issues, you know, we can take it one piece at a time as opposed to trying to do the whole thing. But, you know, you can. I would like to see something that passed the legal test before we sit here and say, well, you know, we'd like to see this part of it say that, and then find out, well, no, you can't, because it's, you know, it's not going to pass the test. So from my perspective, I really want to see the finished product and go from there if there are anything that we want to change or add or delete or whatever. That would be my recommendation. But, you know, if the council wishes otherwise, I'll support that too, but it's just the way I feel. Councilor Zink.
Yeah, I hadn't thought of that. I think you're right, because we're not going to change something from illegal to legal. I mean, that's got to be presented to us. I think what I was hoping to do was to, by seeing it before it went to council, was there are going to be a number of changes that the council is going to want to make. But I think, to your point, Chairman, they're not legal decisions. They're practice decisions.
Which may or may not be legal.
Right. So it'll have to go back.
That's what I was trying to short circuit. It's going back again.
Yeah.
So. And I was just going to say, those areas that legal says, you know, this is what the language needs to say, you could bracket those off. You know, it's easy enough, and then the rest of it, the council can change any way that they see fit. Because things like family medical leave, you're not going to be able to say, oh, we want to do something different. No, it needs to follow this course, and here's what it is. Legal says this complies with what the law says. It's all set. So you set that aside, but you might have other types of things like grievances or stuff the council may want to handle differently, or promotions, or, you know, compensation. Yes.
I can see the way it works.
Okay. Councilman Nazaro.
Yeah, I mean, I would just say that we may inadvertently change something that we don't even realize may cause a legal problem. I would just feel more comfortable if a lawyer saw it after we were mucking about with it. So, yeah, I mean, we probably, you're right. I understand saying, hey, this is a legal thing that we are not going to be able to change. But I don't think a lawyer is going to be sitting here when we're discussing things. So I would personally feel more comfortable if we had, after we change it, then a lawyer sees it. Even if we see a final draft and then make edits to that, I still think we should have a lawyer be the final person that says, yeah, this is all within the bounds of the law. That's my point.
And I guess my only comment to that, Counselor, is we're the ones that's going to vote on it, but I'm not really sure that we're the ones that's changing it. What we're attempting to do is to make sure that what this document has is up to date with current rules, regulations, and what have you. I'm not sure that us changing it is a proper term at this point. I could be wrong. Maybe some councilors feel that they want to change various points of it, but...
It's an update.
Well, yeah, it's to bring us into compliance. I thought that was really the thing. When Ms. Glover sat there or stood there and told us that, you know, no, we're not in total compliance. That's a concern I have. I want to be in total compliance. So if we need to update it to become to that point, to get to that point, we need to do that, and we need to do that yesterday. If we want to make changes to the process, then that's something that I think we can have the discussions at a later date. But I think that the goal of the council was to get the policy so that it was in compliance. And I may be wrong. Maybe I misunderstood, but I that was my goal, is to get this thing so that it's a legal document and there's no gray areas. Councilor Zink.
I'm going to change my mind again. because of the comment, it is not to update personnel policies. Or the, should have two things in them. They should be legally compliant, and they should be tools that the town needs to run itself efficiently. So, for example, family medical leave may say you have to provide X number of weeks of time off. The council may say we're going to provide X number of weeks with time off, but we're also going to pay them during that period. Not that we would, but there are a lot of those kinds of judgments. So I'm going to flip back to, I don't see any downside in getting it to us first and just letting us look at the product. Let us muck around with it a little bit and then send it off to legal. But I see both sides.
Okay. I don't have a problem doing that. And if the council wishes, what I would suggest is that we ask that we receive the draft. But in fairness to getting this done, I would highly recommend that once you get that draft, you have, you know, maybe a 2-week period to, if it's just a question that you have on a particular part, perhaps going to Ms. Glover and saying, you know, is this the way that it has to be, or why did you do this? So that when you come back to the council, we have a meeting and we discuss it, a lot of the answers are already taken care of, because a lot of this stuff is cut and dry. You know, the question is, you know, do we want to become the council that says, well, you know, I'm trying to put it in a, we want to, anything I say is going to come out wrong.
We're all big
fans. I've got a suggestion.
No, it's going to come out wrong to the town. I don't want to do that. But, you know, if the council, for some reason, wants to take away a specific benefit, whatever it is, you know, and they've got reason for doing that, you know, then that's a discussion that we have to have. But if it's just, you know, the little nuances that are within the document, then we, you know, we can hopefully have those done prior to sitting here and discussing it. So it's not a 2-hour discussion. It's more like a half hour, 45-minute discussion. Or, you know, it's a document that needs to be updated not every 3 years, not every 2 years. Probably should be updated every 6 months to current laws and regulations. So it's something that we can continually change and amend if we so choose. But, you know, we have to read it. We have to understand it. So, Mr. Winowski.
I just, you know, and I'm thinking back to the last time that Ms. Glover was here. And the request was for her to come in, you know, once a month and provide the council with some recommendations, and it got down to a point, well, does this really have to be this? And, you know, I mean, all she's trying to do is put together a proposal. There was some stuff that it's legal. She's not going to answer that, and she's just going to say it. Council needs to look at that. So that's the only thing I see as being the question mark, that, you know, if she says that needs a legal review, what I did was I copied what 3 other communities have. And I'm assuming that their legal looked at it and they all agreed, and, you know, then we can move forward. So,
just as a point of reference, we're actually getting a little bit off track here.
Yeah, so. Yeah, exactly. How do we get on?
I don't know. So if we could just go back to whose fault is it?
Me.
So I guess the question is, what part of the charter do we want to take a look at? I've got a number 3 over there.
Three.
Okay, and you know, in all honesty, three may take us to the end of the year, because it is lengthy, and that's fine, because at least we've done something to make the document better. So...
And it deals with the town council.
Can we go to four? I would suggest that you start going through Article 3, coming up with your suggested changes. If at all possible, if you've got ideas or suggestions, get them to Kathy Castle so she can distribute them to the council, so that when we come in here, it's not Councilor Bergeron saying, I'd like to see this change. So we've got a chance to look at it first and could solve maybe a little bit of debate time on it.
What you can do is pull them into each section, like section 3.1, you know, what people want to see. And
we all good with that?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sounds good.
Aye.
Okay. Article 3 it is. Next up is the review of fund balance policies. And you all have a copy of the resolution that was signed back in 2008, which basically states, what was it? I thought I saw 8%. Was it 8%?
Yeah, section 17. 3, 16%.
Yeah.
Which is 2 months, basically.
Yeah, so it's kind of given the levels. Vice Chairman.
I'll just offer a suggestion that we strive to abide by this resolution. I don't see any reason to deviate from it, so.
I totally agree. I think with the situation that the so-called fund balance is in, we should at least strive for, I believe the minimum was a 5%.
Yep.
We should at least strive for that, and then see if we can't creep it up accordingly. Mr. Winowski, I know you made mention about, let me get to the part here.
I talked about the, looking at the
undesignated fund balance. Could you just explain that so that everybody is in, totally understands what?
We have a, there's two pieces. There's the designated fund balance, which are those types of encumbrances or liabilities that the town has, encumbrances from the previous year, contracts or agreements or that we have to hold some dollars to pay some bills that are coming in the next year. And also, I mean, looking at the fire rescue squad building, that's a liability. So that money we can't touch. The undesignated is all the money after that. So if we have $2 million and we have to reserve $1.3 million for the fire rescue squad building, we have $700,000 that's available that can be used to reduce the taxes based upon the fact that, you know, we're going to strive to keep, you know, X amount, you know, 2 months of operating expenses. And if that leaves $10.50, then that's what we have to use to reduce the tax rate. So, but okay. It's just as it says, undesignated means the council can use it to reduce the tax rate or say, no, you know, we're going to keep it because we want to build the fund balance up.
And I assume we've done this in the past.
Yes.
But we've done it without knowing that we've had the 1.3, correct?
No, we've done it with knowing with the 1.3, because it's always been a liability to us. And the when you look at the audit, there's going to be, as Mr. Byron pointed out, he says this is the designated fund balance, and because these are liabilities, whether they be purchase orders, outstanding contractual obligations that you have to meet because you have a contract out there for a project. And then he's shown the undesignated fund balance as being X also. What we find ourselves in is in the undesignated fund balance, we have a negative $24,000 deficit.
Councilor Zink.
It says in here that the town should strive to retain 2 months operating expenses or 16% of the operating budgets. It also says, if you're not going to do that, the town should initiate a plan to replace that specific amount of fund balance as needed. And I think that's the getcha. So we really can't just arbitrarily reduce it. We also have to produce a plan to refund it. So I think that's an important part of this statement, or this this resolution. So if the fund balance is 7%, it is accompanied by a plan that says this is what's going to get us up to 16.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. And what I want to do from now on is, as we get closer to setting the tax rate, to have the finance director come in, and we all look at the numbers. We all look at the paper and say, okay, if we do X, this is what's going to happen.
Is that roughly around October?
October, yes. We strive for that time so that we have it out, you know, and payable by December 1st. That's the goal. And the auditors are in town this week, so they're going through the books.
Okay. Any further questions on this part of the agenda? Number 8, Town Administrator's Report.
The Emergency Management Planning Committee has had their first meeting. That was earlier this month. And they will be holding a second meeting on the 20th of September as they work towards updating the plan. The McAllen Dam Study Committee, Julie Glover and Diane Hardy met with Deb Loisel from the DES Dam Bureau. We had a conference call with the folks from NOAA and the Conservation Law Foundation as to the opportunity for us to get some grant money. It was a very productive meeting. I sat in on that. But Julie, Diane, and Deb have sat down. They've hammered out a pretty good work plan that they're putting the final touches on at this point in time. And it'll be submitted to NOAA and the Conservation Law Foundation on Friday. In response to Ed Porterada's question at the last council meeting as it related to the retirement system and whether the town has seen any increase in cost, we have, and it's a total of $55,129 more than what the town appropriated. That was basically to cover the increase on the employer side of the police and fire. The employee side actually went down pretty significantly. So we only have about, as I said, $55,129 that we're going to have to fund in that area. Not as bad as we thought. We've been continuing the planning with the folks from Timberland for the Servapalooza project that they're going to be doing in town. That is going to take place on Thursday, September 8th. And at the present time, what we are looking at is a reconstruction of the stage at the recreation field, which will incorporate, as you know, is sort of an amphitheater. They're looking to develop a couple of rows where they're going to carve in seating. They're also going to construct seating that will go along the perimeter road for people to sit down and watch acts or performances. They'll be painting the large gazebo green on the outside and a white color on the inside to lighten it up. In addition, they will be doing some artwork and painting various games on the pavement up at the rec field. And inside the rec center, they're going to be constructing shelving in one of the offices, in addition to making new curtains for the windows in the large conference room. We also, they're going to paint the doors to the old fire station down here. They've sort of been a, I don't know what color and white, for a long time since I've been here and talked to Tito Boya. They're going to get some paint, and the Servapalooza people will take care of it. And we're also looking to put a coat of asphalt surface on the parking lot up between the Stone Church and the Historical Museum. Needs some work up there. They anticipate having approximately 100 plus people here on the 8th doing the work, and we completed all in one day. We're going to have to do a little bit of prep work relative to the stage area, because they're going to be lifting it up, securing it to the ground, so we need to do some pylon work and concrete, but the Servapalooza people from Timberland will be here doing that along with probably some of the town crew guys on that regard, so.
So we will be providing some services for the site work.
Okay. Yep. And one of the things they talked about was the possibility of sharing some of the costs for materials. And they're working up that cost, and I will get that to the council as soon as possible. Because the bulk of the work is going to be done down in the rec area, we have the, I don't remember what the name of it is, but the money that was derived from the sale of the property where I believe the Pines is, that's money that needs to be matched with non-tax dollars. So the work that's going to be performed by the Cervapalooza, they're going to be their labor, and they're also contributing to the cost of materials.
So we can use that as a match.
Yes, and that would be able to do that. The town clock, I guess I'm putting this out to all the residents in the community. If you have not seen the mechanism that drives the clock that sits atop the community church downtown, well, it's downstairs in the auditorium, and people are welcome to come in and to see the clock at this point in time. It's set up there. We have it roped off, but you will be looking at the mechanism that drives the hands that for the clock. You see the pendulum arm, and also the new hands that will be going on the clock itself. So it's been cleaned up. It's really neat. There's a lot of extra explanation of the different pieces that have been changed and rehabilitated. So it's going to be there for a little bit longer. Dave Graff is currently looking to coordinate bringing in a lift into town and cording off an area around the church steeple so that he can begin to start setting the clock faces. Once that's completed, we're going to have new electrical lighting that will shine on the faces in the evening. So we've scoped that out. And then the clock mechanism will go back up to its original little home. And on Saturday of the Heritage Festival, the goal is to have the bell start ringing again in the downtown area of Newmarket. I haven't yet received anything from Vanessa and the associates relative to the study for the Fox Hollow.
Oh.
So I just wanted to bring
I talked to him last week, and he said his secretary was sending it out, so okay. Let me check on it.
And then I guess on a sad note, Don Parnell has given me a letter that he will no longer be working for the town effective Friday, August 26. He'll be leaving his position. We have begun to put some advertising out there. There'll be advertising in the Sunday editions of the Union Leader, Foster's, the Portsmouth Herald, and the Concord Monitor. And it's going to run on the local government center and Government Finance Officers Association. And I think within 15 minutes after we put it on the LGC website, I had my first resume that came across my computer screen. So we're looking to have a luncheon for Don on the 24th, which is Wednesday. If any of the councilors wish to be present, it'll be at noon downstairs in the auditorium. And that's about it that I have.
Councilor Bentley.
Just a comment on the study, the stone wall,
Fox Hollow.
Fox Hollow.
Thank you. I was told last week by people from Stonewall that the same developer developed that developed Stonewall that's next to the McIntosh property, and they had some issues, and contractor, the person who did that whole project, is declared bankruptcy and is in Florida. I was told that last week. So any hopes of us thinking we're going to recoup that $1,800 before we sign something, just know that what I'm told from that group, there's nine houses there, and they had a meeting and everyone attended, and the company doesn't exist. They're bankrupt, and the person who heads it is in Florida. So
I believe we are still withholding a performance bond. Are we not?
I believe so. I'm not sure. I'd have to check on that.
Good.
I was told we were. I was told we still had a bond.
Good. And this person would have known that.
I'm not sure that we can even use that, touch that for that purpose.
They watched the meeting and said, hey, just if you think you get anything back, just so you know, we're trying to deal with him too. And he's in Florida. His company's bankrupt. He's down there with his money. And I said, okay, thanks. Good. If we do, we do. That's
Like I said, I'm not sure if we can utilize that money for this purpose, but we do still hold a performance bond on it. Councilor Zink.
Back to your comment on the clock. I was just driving by this morning and looking, wondering whether the clock face had been replaced, and obviously it hasn't. But I'm wondering if there's, if the Historical Society would like one of the clock faces.
That's a good point.
Or whether we're auctioning off, or somebody is, those lawn chairs for...
Yes.
What about if we gave those, I don't even know what it was for, but gave numerals and see if they want it? I just hate to see that stuff get thrown away. And people may get a kick out of having a numeral or a hand.
Yeah, because actually the old hands are downstairs.
Oh, are they?
With the new hands, yes.
Oh, the old and the new?
Yes. I know it because I went and took a look at it a couple of days ago when it was first down there. And there's some of the old parts, and they show them what the new parts look like. So,
I think they have the broken cam that splintered, and
maybe you could get.
Yep,
that's a great way.
I would strongly suggest getting a hold of the Historical Society first to see exactly what they do and do not want. I think that would be the proper way to go. Councilor Bentley,
just another thing, Mr. Administrator, on Don's note here. Under rent of municipal property 48, is that like the Eagles? What municipal property do we have for rental? It shows revenue, 48,000.
We have several pieces of property that we...
Riverdale.
Yeah, we had Riverdale for a while. We also had the tax-deeded properties that we had. We had one of them that was paying. There are... several others. Off the top of my head, I can't remember.
That's
one day, Don gave me a whole bunch of. We had the Eagles for a period of time.
Eagles, Riverdale. Yep. Okay. Yep. All right. So it's just one of those. Thanks.
The parking lot.
You also mentioned that when we did the tour of the Wilson Farm, that you were going to investigate cleaning that property up and renting it. Am I correct?
We had
either
discussion
or.
About
either
it, or right. and I had a conversation with. Rick Malasky, relative to, you know, maybe a controlled burn at that location. There were certain things that he would have to do.
Can we get that on the next agenda just for discussion with the two options that were put forth?
Okay.
Does that work? Any other questions for the town administrator? Okay. In reference to some of the reports that we received from Mr. Hilton and Ms. Glover and everything, I got a couple of things, and Mr. Winowski, I don't know if you may not have the answer to some of these, but if you could get the answers, in particular with the restricted campus update from Mr. Hilton, I was kind of surprised to see that 25% of the parents that were looking to utilize the playground were non-residents. And I guess, you know, they're not allowed to use it. My question would be why. I thought that under any circumstances that property, you know, especially where we've cordoned off an area, you know, I didn't think we were allowed to tell people they couldn't go there, period. So if you can just verify that is true, that he's actually sending non-residents away. And after reading the report, I certainly would hope that next year, unless he has some little tweaking to do, that we continue with the practice that we did this year, because I think it was fairly successful.
Yep. He had mentioned that he thought it worked quite well.
You know, at this point, I would like to see it happen. On the Public Works report, just a question on paving process that we're doing. It seems like we are constantly doing reclaiming of all the paving that we do, and I'm just wondering if there's an option to save on the cost of doing the reclamation if we could just do an overlay I don't know if that's a practical way of doing things today, but to me, it would seem like it might be a way that we could save some money and maybe get an extra road or two done. And in reference to the other projects where they mentioned the flagpole at the library, there's been a dirt pile there and a 4x8 sheet of plywood laying on the ground now since the old flagpole came down, and I was just wondering if there was some issue there with electrical or something, or why it hasn't been cleaned up. So if you could check on that. Yep. And then on Dawn's report, what do I have? On Dawn's report, on page 7 of the current year expenditures, I think I may have discussed this with you previously, but we give the Newmarket Athletic Association $21,500 per year, and it's my understanding that they have a fair amount of money in reserve, and I'm wondering if before we go and do the 21.5 next year or whatever we're going to present as a proposal, if we could get an idea as to what the bank account is actually. I mean, if we're giving them 21.5, I would like to think that the 21.5 is being utilized on a yearly basis. So, and that was all I had. Councilor Zink.
On the administrative services director memo, I think number 3, which talks about the fact that, and I'll just read it, and it relates to medical and dental insurance. Unfortunately, at the present time, the town's medical claims costs are extremely high, thus making it difficult, if not impossible, to obtain quotes outside of the local government center. And there's a comment, we may wish to focus on returning to a self-insured model. I'm going to bring this up now for the 18th time. When we've got a population of 52 employees, it's always going to be up and down. And I would really appreciate it if somebody would sit down with folks at the school, and they have 202 employees, 204, something like that. This, we're going to be facing this forever unless somebody sits down with the school and starts treating this medical plan like a town medical plan, like a Newmarket's medical plan rather than the town's. And, we will never be able to get outside the local government center with a population of 52. It's too risky.
I don't think that she has not talked to the folks next door.
Well,
I will ask her that question.
Again, my comment is I think it's more than talk, because we're talking about an option being returning to a self-insured model. That's the consideration. What I would like to see is something in here that says the school's unwilling to work with us, the school, it's something, and bring this thing to a conclusion. It's going to kill us.
And you know, what she has done is, you know, we've sent our claims history to outside vendors.
Right.
And they've looked at us and said,
they wouldn't touch you.
We're not even going to touch you.
Right.
We're not even going to quote. That's why we're
too small a population.
Yeah. Too small a population. We have some situations that have occurred.
Is that Councilor?
Yes. Thank you.
Vice Chairman?
I have two things. One is on Ms. Glover's report. On the second item, she anticipates working with the DPW director and the town administrator to recruit two key positions in the last quarter of 2011. Could you update us on, and I looked at Rick's report also, it looks like there's been some turnover at the DPW. Can you just give us an update on and what those two key positions are?
I think that probably the one that I'm thinking that maybe will be the current foreman position.
Is that a person that's retiring?
It's a person who is currently on leave.
Okay.
And the other one, we're still looking for hiring or bringing on board someone in the area of the...
Equipment operator.
Equipment operator, yes.
Okay, so, and those are...
There would be no other key position that I know of in the...
And, but those are the two positions...
No.
With me.
Yeah, but those are the two positions that...
Yeah.
We, people have left those positions in the recent past.
Right.
Right, okay.
One has and one we still have on, even though he's on a leave.
Right, right, exactly. The other thing is it relates to both Ms. Glover's and Mr. Malasky's report. Under five on Julie's report, she mentions, you know, ongoing work, continuing to close out Leo Landrock B Field Project. And on Rick's report, under other projects, it says, the B Field Project continues to be a struggle as we continue to try to get the contractor to remedy deficiencies. Can we get an update on what those deficiencies are and how significant they are and where we are?
Sure. I can briefly tell you that as it relates to Leo Landrock Field, we have already contacted council about pulling the bond. Because it has been a almost from day one of the project when the principal of the company promised us that he would have people and personnel and it would be a short-term project, it has turned out to be the most laborious and most gruesome and most difficult, and you know, it's just something all the time. And when we have set up meetings, we've been promised things and it's not followed through. And we just had a point that we've contacted the attorney, we've sent all the information to him, and we're asking to proceed to a point that we're going to call the bond and finish the project and do what we have to do.
What are the physical issues? Is drainage one of the issues?
No, drainage is not an issue.
Could we get a list?
I have no idea what they are at this point. So if you just have Rick or Julie, whoever knows, just put together a list say here's the issues that
bring it on
are
the 7th.
Yep.
Have it for the 7th, and maybe have one of them here for discussion as to where we are in the mix of this.
Yeah, the Main Street is just mainly closing out the documents at this point.
Yeah, right, which we've given the approval to go ahead and do.
Yep.
Right. Now, specific to the B
field. But the Leo Landrock Field is, yes, we need to bring that.
I'm all set. Thank you.
All set?
Yep.
Okay, anything else on any of the other updates? Okay, I noticed on the agenda there is no old new business. Mr. Winowski, and it's my fault because I didn't catch it on the agenda that you sent me. We're gonna have it. I would really appreciate if we make sure we have that on every agenda. And actually, I do have some old and new business, which...
Funny how that...
Yeah.
What a lead-in.
Well, no, there's just a couple of things that I'd like to get clarified is... one of them is in reference to the purchase of the new video equipment that the school received, the $20,000 from us, I believe it was.
Yes.
It was $27,000 in expenses, and it was stated at the last school board meeting that the town was picking up the additional $7,000, and that's not what we signed up for. So if we can try to rectify that and make sure everybody's on the same page, it was my understanding that the school was footing that whole bill. And if I'm wrong, counselors, please correct me, but that was my understanding, and it was clearly stated that, no, the town's going to use the equipment, so therefore they're going to pay for some of it, and I don't think that was part of the deal. So if we could just check on that. The other thing is Councilor Zink had offered when we first got started, see what happens when you offer? He had offered when we first got started on drawing up a new form that would be a little more adequate for doing our evaluation on the town administrator. And first off, I'd like to ask Councilor Zink if he's still willing to do that.
Yes.
And if the council is in favor of him doing that and presenting it to us so that it's something that we can actually work with and be a little easier on getting things done so we can do this on time and...
Absolutely.
You know, so...
I think Councilor Zink is the right person for that.
Okay. So, having said that, I see Councilor Bentley's light on. Is it for any of this stuff or have you got some old new business?
Old new.
Okay, let's hold off on you. Counselor Zink is, let's hold off on you, because I got one more. The project updates that we had drawn a, that I had put a form together last year, I think it was, you know, which had various items on it. If we could start to get that prior to each meeting, at least so we know what these items are, and also I'm sure we have several new ones to add to it. So if we could just work on getting that updated over the next couple of weeks. Councilor Nazaro, I don't know if you know which form we're actually talking about, but
I'm assuming it's just a standard.
Yeah.
What I'll also do is in the interim, put the form with just the titles in each of your boxes.
Okay.
And I think it'd be useful if you would go through that.
Yeah, because there's probably some that we can take off.
Scratch off what you think.
Yes.
You know, which we've completed, and add others that you want to be on there.
Okay.
That's
great.
Fine.
So if we can just get back, and I'd really like to do it every meeting, because I think it just keeps us a little more focused on cleaning up some of the smaller items that we need to address.
Yep.
So, Councilor Bentley.
Can I make a comment on?
Okay.
Just a suggestion. That report that we generate is our issues that we need to face. As a council or need to address. I'm wondering if it would be a good idea on that same report to start off that report with each of our four goals in writing, so they don't get out of our way, and permanently
every packet.
Yep.
Permanently put them in front of us and say, where are we on whatever.
I get to say that?
Yes.
Only kidding.
Councilor Bentley, you all set?
Yes.
Councilor Bentley.
Three quick things. Old Home Weekend was a great success, and you know, I saw a lot of the folks that are sitting here right now at it, and kudos to the group that, you know, did a fine job putting that on. It was a great day. A lot of people brought in a lot of business. I saw a lot of outside faces in the restaurants and on the street, and then a lot of the locals, all the old timers that remember when it was downtown. So good job for everyone involved in that. I received a note, a 7-page note from someone. I believe you live on Exeter Road, and I can't respond to you because I'm not sure who you are, but thank you for the note. If you just leave me your name, I'll respond to you. And lastly, Dan Dickens and his family are leaving, and I just thought we should thank him for his time in the council, his time in the volunteer fire department, and his tireless time doing a lot of coaching, and wish him and his family best moving to Florida. So just want to bring that up.
Councilor Zink.
I don't know whether this is old business or new business, but and I don't know whether I should do it through a motion or not, but my intent is to ask the council if it would reconsider the vote to spend money on the Great Bay Municipal Association study. I'm making that request for two reasons. Number one, I think it was a 3-3 vote, and I would, of something of such significance, I think the full council should have an opportunity to vote on it. Secondly, quite frankly, after tonight's meeting, I have a different opinion than I did when I made my vote after listening to the gentleman tonight from the EPA, and I'd like some time to if the council approves on reconsidering it, I'd like some, just to put some time in thinking on it. And thirdly, a number, not a large number, but a number of folks asked me why I didn't vote for it last time while I was at the Heritage Festival, and a couple of folks on my street. And I know there's some interest on some citizens' part to give us some input. That's probably the most important thing. I hope citizens will take advantage, if we have a revote, reconsideration, to get to us and let us know what they feel, because it's such a significant issue. So those are my reasons. don't know how, whether I do it by motion or...
Would you like to make that as a motion?
I'd like to make a motion.
But if he did, would we vote? Would we vote tonight, or we just make it?
No.
So there's...
I'd like to make a motion that the council reconsider, is that the right term, the vote to spend money to support the Great Bay Municipal Association study once the council, once we have a full council.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second, and you did say when we have a full council.
I think it's a full council and, yeah, and citizen input.
So, is this in reference to that?
Yes, yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
I was just going to ask the town administrator, and maybe the question, you answered the question already. What is the appropriate avenue to do that? Is it just a motion with a vote for reconsideration?
Yes.
That, okay.
Brings it back up.
But it has to be by the prevailing vote, which in that case it was a failure, and he voted against the nomination, so he is able to make that motion. Yep. I couldn't make the vote motion, and you couldn't make it because you voted in favor of the study.
So, and that was the side that did not
correct
win, so it was
correct.
A prevailing vote. Okay.
Right. Councilman Nazaro?
Yeah, it's a procedural question. Since I was not present for the original vote, can I vote on the
yes.
I can vote on the total reconsideration, but the request to reconsider,
no,
can I vote on that?
You can vote
on that. And the councilor did put in his motion with a full council, which means seven of us. So to all councilors that are here this evening, do you see, do you plan on not being available for the 7th, barring unforeseen circumstances, which is our next meeting? Okay, then what I will do is I will get in touch with Councilor Levy and make sure that he will be available for that meeting. And if he is and we have a full council, we'll do the vote, the reconsideration of vote that evening if the motion passes. Okay, any further discussion? Councilor Nazaro?
Yeah, just a quick question. I mean, in the spirit of what Councilor Zink said, would we want to put it on the agenda and have the ability for people to speak about it prior to the meeting? Is a public session at the beginning of the next meeting, right?
Yes.
Put it as the first item on the agenda.
Yeah, and we will allow public comment on that part of the agenda.
Good.
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? Mr. Manowski, will you call the vote, please?
Councilor Bentley?
Aye.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor Zink?
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro?
Aye.
Councilor Bodiman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 6-0. Okay, so I will check with Councilor Levy. Any other, Councilor, Vice Chair?
I have two things under new business. Mm-hmm. First one is Ms. Manowski just stated in his report that the extra costs associated with the retirement is going to be $55,000. Do we have, or are you in the process of putting together a plan to offset that? Or what are the, how, that's an additional $55,000 that we have to spend, right?
Yep.
Extra cost of what?
Retirement. The retirement for the
town's portion.
The town's portion of the retirement for the police, right?
Police and
fire. But that has, does that not have to be offset somewhere with savings? Because we can't overspend the bottom line.
Right. And within like DPW, we have currently three positions that are not filled.
So that's being offset by that?
Yes.
Okay. That's all my question was. The other thing is, and I called Ed this afternoon about this, what Councilor Bentley had mentioned about Old Home Weekend. I got a couple of complaints about the brochure associated with Old Home Weekend, that it was appeared to be a brochure for an Oyster Fest, not so much Old Home Weekend. And actually, the Exeter newsletter said, I believe it was the Exeter newsletter, said the Oyster Fest. It didn't say anything about Old Home Weekend or Old Home Day. So the question was concerned about who paid for the brochure, and it was the town that paid for the brochure.
Well, to clarify that, the town gives the Old Home Weekend $8,500.
Right.
And from that, all of the different events, the vendors, not the vendors, but the the musical acts we had, police, were all paid out of that, so.
Yes, but so the, but the question that I was asked was, who paid for that? It came from the money that we gave to them to do. That's all I wanted to put that out there. I was asked a question, so I wanted to get the answer.
And sort of the goal over the, you know, last year, it sort of, it just was, you know, well, let's see how this works. And this year, to sort of blend the two, so that way what we're doing is we're getting people aware of the river and the opportunity, you know, you get oysters from there. And the nice part about the oysters that we had this year was they all came from the Great Bay. Nitrogen and all.
Nitrogen is delicious.
Yes.
And I mean, and it certainly is a matter of, it's a matter of opinion, but I just want to put out there that that was a question I was asked, so.
Yep.
That's it. Thank you.
Yes, Councilor. Any other old new business? Okay, we do have a non-public. So, Councilor, Vice Chair?
I will make a motion that we go into non-public session under RSA 91A 3, Roman numeral 2, subsection C, for matters which if this...
I thought we were just approving non-public minutes.
And E. Well, I was going to read one than the other, but for RSA 91A 3, colon 2, subsection C and E, which is matters which, if discussed in public, would likely affect adversely the reputation of any person other than a member of the council itself, and consideration of pending claims and litigation.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Councilor?
Yeah, I guess 9A, non-public minutes.
Right, but non-public session, it does state section, agenda item 9 does say that we're going into a non-public session. So we can do the minutes in the non-public session.
Okay.
Okay. Any other discussion? Mr. Winowski, we call the vote.
Councilor Bentley?
Aye.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor Zink?
Aye.
Councilor Nazaro?
Aye.
Councilor Bodeman?
Aye.
Chairman LaBranch?
Aye. Motion carries 6-0. We are in non-public.